Okay, we've got two big product announcements. Well, technically three. A lot of which I was excited for, and a lot of things I'm disappointed in. It kind of moves back and forth. I'm like, hey, new Series 4! But they killed the edition. Oh, the new iPhone XS! But it starts at $1,000, not $900. Ooh, the new iPhone XR. Why R? Rainbow for the color? Regular? Really weird? Really dumb? That's $50 more than what we were originally expecting at $700. I guess on a monthly plan, doesn't make a huge difference, but wow, look at all these color options! Pre-orders have to start next month, and it doesn't look like you'll be able to get it unlocked. Luckily, the iPhone XS Max, still weird name, tennis match, but the leaks ended up being real. All of those concepts we got early were totally real. A lot of details to go over. I will do my best to sum it up for you now. They started off things very, very quickly, 10 minutes in, announcing the Apple Watch Series 4. As I said, those leaks were absolutely correct, and it does look beautiful. I see what they meant by gather around, because the corners are very, very curved, but still not going all the way to a round Apple Watch display. All I can say is, I like it. It looks very futuristic, it looks very minimal. I'm definitely excited to get one. The Series 1 Apple Watch has been discontinued. The price of the Series 3 is now lower. There is no more stainless steel Series 3, like I have right now. You can't get that anymore, but now the regular GPS-only Series 3 starts at just under $300, and the price of the Series 4 is $50 more than what the starting price of the Series 3 was. We got a 35% larger display, so now the new resolutions are 40mm and 44mm, but the old Apple Watch bands will still work with this Apple Watch, which I'm confused by, because now you're gonna have a bunch of bands that say 38mm, 42, but they'll be compatible with watches that say 40mm and 44. This confuses the lineup, but I'm okay with that confusion as long as our current Apple Watch bands still work with our old Apple Watch bands. Other tidbit of good news is that the Series 4 is not cellular only. Some people were thinking that you could only get it with cellular. Turns out that's not true. There are GPS only options starting at $399, which, like I said, is a little bit more than we were expecting, but you are also getting a larger speaker, an EKG heart rate monitor on the Apple Watch itself. It's a solid state home button. Microphone's supposed to be better at reading your voice. And like I said at the beginning of the video, they discontinued the Apple Watch edition. There is no more ceramic white or space gray Apple Watch now. Stainless steel is the best Series 4 you can get. Was not expecting that. That was kind of random, and I was kind of debating if I should get the edition for a while. Apple made that decision for me, but that's okay, because that means you don't have to spend $1,300 on a watch anymore. I also love the new blush gold option with Series 4, because it looks like the original Apple Watch edition that was actually made of gold. It appears they were able to replicate that look with stainless steel, which is good because it looks awesome. They brought 64-bit architecture to the internals of the Apple Watch, so speed and the way apps open and stuff should be a lot better. They introduced a suite of new watch faces that all look amazing. Really excited to mess with all of them. Watch faces that have like so many different modules and so many different complications than we've ever seen before. It's going to be a huge step up from the Series 3, and the battery life is still the same. It's not better, it's not worse, it's exactly where it was before, which I understand. Galaxy Watch is really good battery life. Android Wear and Wear OS likes to be very proud of the battery life they can get, but that's not helping their sales, and that's because more people want a better user experience, and that's why more people buy Apple Watches. And my battery life has been fine. I can easily get it to 3 days if I need it to. So I'm okay with them keeping that battery life. More battery would have been good, but I'll be okay without it. The back of the Apple Watch Series 4 has been redesigned to just have one light on the back, an array of different sensors that measure your heart rate more accurately, and the entire back of every Series 4 is now ceramic, unlike the Series 3, where it was ceramic if you got it in cellular, but if you didn't, it was Ion X glass. So there's a lot more glass on the back of the Apple Watches now. Hopefully that helps with inductive charging, which brings me to AirPower. No mention of AirPower. It's been a year now since they announced it, and guess what? There's not even an AirPower section in the iPhone tab anymore. Made me think, oh no, did they discontinue it? Did they kill it off? Turns out AirPower is still present in the AirPods tab, but it says wireless charging AirPods case unavailable right now, so I don't know if that means AirPower is completely dead and gone, but they're definitely pushing it off. Maybe there's even more problems than we realize, but I'm so sick of talking about the fact that AirPower is not being brought up or mentioned or addressed. It's bugging the heck out of me, and we really, really need to get some answers. Is it done? Is it dead? Is it never coming back? Is it in the works? Are they working on it? I have no idea. Just one of many of the disappointments we got today. So, moving into the iPhones, XS is the name. The leaks were absolutely correct about that, and XS Max. Screen resolutions and everything we predicted were spot on. The XS Max has the the same pixel per inch as the XS, so very high resolution display for an iPhone. Biggest iPhone display we've ever gotten in the past. Luckily, that notch is the same size though, so it takes up less of your screen. All you OCD people out there will hate the bottom of the XS because it seems like they've added another cell band. Maybe that helps with the new gigabit speeds they've added with these iPhones, because the speaker grills are not symmetrical. On the right, you have more holes than you have on the left. Doesn't really ruin the experience or anything, but yeah. If you like things to be symmetrical, this is going to bother you. What also is going to bother you is they are not including fast chargers with any of the new iPhones. Something we really were hoping for this year and hoping to see USB-C to Lightning and cables included. Still nothing. It kills me that they still cannot include fast chargers with the new iPhones. Yes, it comes in this new blush gold color, which looks awesome. Looks like solid gold iPhone. It looks really nice. And they even let you configure it up to 512 gigs of storage, which I don't understand. That costs like, you can configure an iPhone to cost over $1,500 now for a single phone that won't even ship with a fast charger. I'm amazed that they went that high. I'm definitely not getting 512. 64 gig all the way. The XS Max is already a little more expensive than I was predicting at $1,100. We thought it'd be $1,000. We were being way too optimistic. Apple always surprises us with the pricing. The regular sized iPhone XS stays at the $1,000 starting price, and last year's current iPhone X is no longer being sold. You can't buy it from the Apple Store website or the app anymore. They're just telling everyone, wait for the new ones where pre-orders start this Friday. Once again, as we predicted, and then deliveries will be a week from that Friday. So this price is going to stay the same, except with the faster CPU, A12 chip. It's really fast. It's faster. It's the fastest chip ever. That's all you really need to know about it. They say there's some software enhancements with the camera that allow for better picture photography, like being able to adjust the background of your pictures now. In video recording now, you have stereo microphones, so you can get better audio when doing recording. But the most noticeable video improvement I noticed as a vlogger on Talos of Talks, we do vlogs all the time, they've now added 1080p at 60 frames a second recording on the front-facing camera, which for an iPhone, 60 FPS on the front hasn't been an option before. So the TrueDepth camera now supports that, which I'm excited for because that means you can do some really high-quality vlogs while still being able to look at the display. You don't have to hold it backwards like I usually do in order to get that higher resolution, higher frame rate. Now you won't have to do that anymore. Once again, I think they rely on the A12 to do all of their fixing for them. They keep saying Face ID is better now because of the A12. iOS is better now because of the A12. Taking pictures is better because of the A12. AR kit is better because of A12. I'm sure a lot of it is true, but I doubt a lot of it is noticeable. Stereo speakers apparently on the XS Max sound a bit better. I'll have to find out in person when I actually try one. And they also added IP68 water resistance, something we've had on the Galaxy lines for a while, to the iPhone XS and XS Max. So it can be 2 meters deep for 30 minutes now and still be okay, which is good. I've wanted IP68 for a while. I wanted that last year. Now they brought it along. Also good to know. And the battery lives are just very slightly improved. The XS Max gets 90 minutes more battery than the iPhone X, which I guess is slightly better. Not drastically better, but it's a little better. And then the regular size iPhone XS also got a 30-minute battery improvement. So in the long run, barely any battery change. No change there. But I will add that the display looks gorgeous. I'm very excited to get my hands on a larger size iPhone X. I'm happy that there are storage options out there for people who want half a terabyte. It's just not me. And I am disappointed in the pricing because I really wanted to believe those rumors that they were going for lower cost this year and not going to price the XS Max at $1,100. But in the back of my head, I always knew that's what it was going to be. I predicted it several times. So, makes sense. This is Apple we're talking about. And then moving into the very, very bizarre star of the show, iPhone XR. We thought it would start at $700. Actually, is $750, so a little more than we thought. Comes in a wide array of 6 different colors, including coral, the same color that Google uses for their Google Home Mini that no one wants, the coral color. Basically pink. It's weird. They go with a very vibrant blue. Luckily, product red available at launch, which is good. But yeah, the iPhone XR is delayed. The pre-orders aren't starting until October. For some reason, design holdups are causing them to have to push it till later, unlike the XS and XS Max, which will be available in the next couple weeks. The XR, I will add, looks really good, though, for an LCD display, the fact that they don't really have a chin on it. The side bezels are a little bit thicker than they would be on the iPhone X, but for the most part, it very much resembles the iPhone X that was $1,000 last year that everyone wanted to buy. And I imagine this one is going to be fairly popular as well, given its wide array of colors, its cheaper price point, and the fact that they're able to keep things like Tapped Awake. But in the keynote, they did bring up it doesn't have 3D Touch. This is not something normal for Apple to do. Phil kind of glossed over it. He was like, no, it doesn't have 3D Touch. But it has haptic feedback, which means that when you hold down on certain things in iOS, it will give you haptic feedback like it was 3D Touch, but it's not really measuring how hard you're pressing the display. Kind of like how when you're on your iPad and you hold on certain things and it behaves like 3D Touch, they brought this to the iPhone XR. Why the R? I don't know. I still can't figure it out. You know, with the 5C, I thought it stood for like colorful or cheap. And I think they brought that up during the iPhone 5C keynote. With this, R, I don't understand, but it only has one rear-facing camera, but they did what Google did with the Pixel, and they now allow portrait mode via AI, so they can blur the background of pictures and give you portrait mode pictures with one rear-facing camera, just like the Pixel phones have done for a while, but the difference is, if you want a dual camera, Apple makes a phone with dual cameras. But it makes me wonder if you'll be able to do portrait mode photography with the wide-angle lens on the regular XS and XS Max. They didn't really talk about it, so I'm not sure. But it's good to see that even on budget phones, even with phones that don't have a dual camera, you can still do portrait viewing with blurred backgrounds and stuff like that. It's the same A12 chip. There were some rumors going around that the XR would get the lower spec A11 chip. That's not true. It gets the same CPU. And from what it sounds like, the XR, I think, has the best battery life of any iPhone. Bizarrely, even though it's not the most expensive, it has a 90-minute larger battery life than the 8 Plus, which a lot of people were bringing up. The 8 Plus battery is better than the iPhone X. The XR has an even better battery than the 8 Plus, so that's pretty good, decent battery life. They don't tell you the milliamp hours because Apple probably thinks that doesn't matter because it matters about how the CPU uses the battery, not necessarily the size. I'm sure you can Google it and someone's already commented it. Spoiler alert though, it's likely not 4,000 milliamp hours like the Note 9, okay? Likely not gonna be huge specs in that department. But still, even longer battery life than already the pre-existing Plus phones, that's gonna be pretty nice for a lot of people. It has a pixel density of 326, which is a little bit better than we were anticipating. Some people were thinking it was gonna be a 720p display. It's a little bit better than that. It's around 820 pixels, so that's also good to know, but doesn't quite reach the realm of 1080p. So I imagine the pixel density might be a little bit distracting, but I imagine for the general consumer, it's probably not going to be noticeable. And with that updated camera on the front, you also get 1080 at 60 on the front, just like you do with the XS. So this is gonna be an interesting phone. It's gonna be fairly appealing. The XR did not get IP68. It still has IP68 and stereo speakers. So I think Apple really focused on what do people want. Let's just get the bare necessities down and try to make a more affordable option. It's by no means a budget phone. $750 is pretty premium for most people, but a lot of people are on monthly plans, and not to mention the new prices for the other iPhones, the ones that were already existent, like the iPhone 8 Plus. They got rid of Product Red, so that's officially gone, but the 8 Plus now starts at $700. You can get an actual dual camera setup, Touch ID, no notch, if you don't care about the bezel-less trend, for less money than the XR. So I feel like that might be attractive to a lot of people. And officially, the iPhone SE, the iPhone 6S, they're gone, they're discontinued. That means no more headphone jacks. And the iPhone 7 starts at $450 now, and if you go refurbished, under $400. So that, I think, is the budget market Apple would want you to go to. They're not gonna make a new phone that's intentionally budget. They're just going to lower the prices of their older phones. But the XR definitely is a lot more achievable for a lot of people compared to the XS and XS Max, which is getting into the super luxurious market. Now, I criticized the Note 9 for having half a terabyte of storage because I was like, who actually needs that? I'm doing the same thing here with the XS Max, okay? There's no special treatment. I don't understand who would need that much storage. It's definitely not me. I'm not buying that. And that's an insane price for a phone. $1,500? Are you serious? I don't understand that. I don't know why it's there, but it's there. So I'm sure a lot of you are disappointed about the things we didn't see at the keynote today. No iPad, no MacBook, no Mac Mini or any of that stuff I told you guys not to get excited about. And it turns out it's a good thing I did because there were a lot of things that we were expecting and didn't get. No new AirPods, no AirPower, no Macs, no iPads, any of that stuff. It was a complete no-show for a lot of products that we were expecting. So I completely agree with you if you were disappointed with this keynote. The pricing was a little disappointing. The no fast charging is disappointing. The lack of certain options that a lot of people were looking forward to, that's very disappointing. So I totally get it. There's a few things I'm definitely looking forward to. What they did talk about I thought was fun and interesting. But overall, very, very meh keynote overall. This is an S upgrade year. We weren't expecting that much change, but still, this keynote felt very basic and very subtle and Like, there wasn't really that much to catch. And if you're out there thinking, I didn't need to stay up late for this, I didn't need to miss work or school for this, you're probably right. You could have read about this online and be fine. But I really hope people did enjoy this keynote and found the good things a part of it. If you can, that's great for you. I'm happy that you can be an optimist. Either way, I'm looking forward to the Series 4 and the XS Max. I'll be getting them as soon as they're available. Let me know your guys' favorite part of the keynote. We all know how upset we are about all the things that we didn't get. Let's try to focus on the positive. Let me know your favorite things in the comments. This is your Apple Shapir. I'll see you in the next one.